everyone, good evening and welcome to yet another amazing class with us by Jews. I'm Aishwarya and today's class is going to be a super interesting class where we are going to be learning about digestion in ruminants. So welcome everyone, welcome to the class. I can see Anik is here. Hi Anik, good evening. Hi Dilip Kumarja, I can see that a lot of you are here. Yes. I can see a lot of other names as well. Hello, Mukesh. I could see a lot of them. Hi, Sunidhi. Yes, welcome to the class, everyone. Yes, Ayushi, I do remember all of you. Of course, I do. Hi, Anita. I can see Musfira. That's a very interesting name. Hi, Naira. Hi, Ritika. Hi, you know, I can see Adrija is here. Welcome. I can see that totally we have around 15 to 20 students, right? Jobika is also here. Welcome everyone. So we'll wait for about 2-3 minutes and then we're going to get started. Now today's class is going to be a very simple class where we will learn about digestion in ruminants and we'll have a deeper understanding and a little more than what we see and read in our NCRT. So I really hope that all of you have your notebooks and pen with you. And if not, you don't have it, you don't want to make too many notes, you can always have your textbook with you and you can just make notes on your textbook, right? So make sure that you have all of this ready with you. Yes, all right. So can you quickly tell me how many students we have on the live? Yeah? 21 students are here. That is amazing. All of you, very quickly, I would request all of you to tell your friends to join this class as well. Because this topic, right, if you understand it in detail properly at one go, it becomes the easiest topic. And in your exams, here and there, they do give you questions based on this. So it is good to have a detailed understanding. Yes. All right, everybody, let's get started. So in the meanwhile, till our friends come in, here's a quick reminder for all of you to be a part of the Akash National Talent Hunt exam. Now, for all you 7th to 12th graders, the registration is absolutely free. Link is there in the description. All you need to do is to go register yourself. We are going to be telling you the syllabus for Anthe very soon. We'll also be starting classes for the same. We'll help you with the preparation so that you can get your taste at competitive exams. Now, I know you are here at a very young age and you may think that, ma'am, why should I give competitive exams, right? Now, the reason being is exposure. Yes, it's always good to be exposed to these kinds of things. It's important to give it a try at least once, right? No matter what the result, please give a try once, because if you do, you all stand a chance to win up to 100% scholarship. You know, you will be competing with students all over India. You will, of course, there is scope for cash rewards and the most coveted NASA trip. Now, the exam is scheduled to be in November. You have both online and offline modes, so make sure that you do register for it. I will definitely share the notes, don't worry about it. Now, of course, we also know that the Mission Midterm Series is going on. It's a 45-day plan that we have wherein we will be doing chapter one-shots, chapter revisions, we'll have exam-focused questions, marathon series, doubt-solving classes, strategy sessions. There's going to be so much of it. And all we request you to do is to stay subscribed to our channel. Hit that subscribe button. And I hope all of you, you're saying 22 students are here. I hope all 22 of you will be part, right? I hope you are all subscribed to the class. Now, so again, I think this is a slight misunderstanding. So if you are competing, right, you will be challenging amongst yourselves. It's there. It's just that it's there at every grade, right? Which means that for 7th grade, you will all be there. Then for 8th grade, you will all be there, right? Yes, Jovika has participated and got a merit scholarship. Wonderful, Jovika. So this year is a very, you know, open space for you to tell how your experience was and tell your friends to register for the same, right? And of course, quick reminder that the Byju's mini learning program is back with a new code, that is the YT First code. Yes? So before I go ahead and tell you about the YT First code, can we make me small on screen? I'm looking very big and I'm covering the code that is there. So of course, for all of you, use the YT First code, right? Where in the first 1,000 users, it will be free for all of you. So be part of those 1,000 users. Don't forget about it, right? And you know that in the mini learning program, there's a lot of advantages, the two-teacher advantage, post-class sessions, yes, and a lot more. So it's time for all of you to be a part of this as well. So now I can see that we have a good number of 30 students in the class, and without wasting any more time, we are going to get started with the class. Yes, so now of course when we talk about digestion in ruminants, right, we often talk about cows. And I'm sure all of us would have seen cows, right? Seeing cows are not the first time. I mean, all of us would have seen cows. Yes? Can you all tell me? You've all seen cows, right? I'm asking you such a simple question. This is very simple and easy. We've all seen cows. We would have seen cows maybe standing in one corner and they'll be chewing and eating, right? We often observe that. Yeah, it's a very cute calf that we have on screen. Yes. We've all, you know, they're very, you know, cows are not, you know, they'll not be running around. They're not very, you know, maybe excited like how you'd see sometimes, you know, dogs are there. They're very excited and they keep running around. But yes, you'll find them standing on roads. They'll just be minding their own business and they'll be chewing most of the time. So most of the time, if you see, we'll constantly keep seeing them chewing like this. So why is all of this happening? Which is, and most importantly, why are we using the term ruminants when it comes to cows? So we are going to be understanding all of this in today's class. Now we know what is digestion, right? We are all aware about digestion. Can you quickly tell me what is digestion in the chat? What do we mean by this term digestion? Yes? Very good, Ayushi. Yes. And we'll be learning about it also. Yes, everyone, quickly can you tell me what do we mean by this term digestion? It's a very simple one and a very important term as well that you need to know when it comes to this particular chapter. And trust me, today's class is a very simple class wherein we will be wrapping it up in half an hour. So no issues. By 7:30, we'll be done today. Digestion of food, okay. Breakdown. Very good, Adrija. Yes, very good, Ayushi. So when we say digestion, it is the breaking down of food from complex form into simple soluble forms. Yes? So all of you out there, make sure that you write this definition down. What do we mean by the term digestion, right? Simple soluble forms that can be absorbed. Now we know that whether it's us human beings or if it's any other animal, they need to digest their food and only then will they be able to utilize the nutrients from the food. And most often when we talk about cattle, right, or when we talk about, let me just talk about cows in general. Now when we talk about cows, we know that most often cows are considered to be herbivores, right? And we know that herbivores are those animals which feed on only plants, right? In nature. So I'm going to specify this because some of you might be telling me, ma'am, we have seen, you know, maybe sadly some cows may be found feeding on, you know, maybe something else, right? Sometimes maybe they, when they're trying to pick up the food from, you know, somewhere else, they may pick out on other substances, but we don't need to, you know, worry about that. Primarily in nature, they are found feeding on only plants, right? Now we know that the process or how do these plants enter into the body, right? Yes, very good. Herbivores means only plants. Now we see here that for the cows to feed on the plants, they eat with their mouth, or we see that they ingest the food through their mouth. So it is very similar to how it happens in our body, right? So we also take in food through our mouth and ingestion takes place. So they eat and they feed on it. Now what's very interesting is that, you know, surprisingly, although cows that are there where they, you know, they tend to chew very slowly, the cows actually feed on it very fast. So they take it up real quick because you know that in nature, right, sometimes these cows or some herbivores, they're exposed to predators also. So they don't spend too much time ingesting the food. They are very fast with ingesting. Now, once they take it all in, they later they're like, then I will decide what I need to do, right? So they will feed it in through their mouth. And can you quickly tell me what all will we find in the mouth? You can take the example of humans and only tell me. What would we find in the mouth? What are all the parts that we would find? Can you all tell me? I will tell you what is rumen, Ravinder. Don't worry. Very good. Buccal cavity. Yes, the mouth will open into the buccal cavity or the oral cavity. And in that cavity, what will we find? That is what I want to know. Yes, we will find teeth. Very good. We will find tongue. Then what else will we find? Gums, okay, yes, teeth will be, you know, found in the gums. Very good. What else? Esophagus will not be there in the mouth. We're talking about what is there in the buccal cavity. Very good. Salivary glands. We will find salivary glands which produce saliva. So very similar to us, they also produce saliva, they have tongue, they have teeth, all of it is the same. But how is it different from us, right? Now in our body, let's talk about teeth. Can you quickly tell me how many types of teeth do we have? Do we have two types of teeth, three types of teeth, or four types of teeth? In the chat, can you tell me? Very good, very good. Yes, we have four types of teeth, right? So we have incisors, canines, molars and premolars. But in the case of cows, when we talk about the teeth, we see that they have around 32. They have only incisors, right? So we don't need to focus on this number, but we need to focus on the type. So they have incisors, they have premolars and they have molars. Now notice how they do not have canines. They have no canines. Simply because we know that canines help in tearing into the food, right? Tearing and biting, in, like especially with tearing it off. And we know that canines are prominent in carnivores. But for these cows, they don't need those canines. There's no function, which is why we find only incisors, molars and premolars. And interestingly, if you notice, these are the incisors that are there. And on the lower jaw, they have proper incisors, right? But if you see here on top, they don't have incisors on top, right? But rather what they will have is, they will have a hard dental pad. So it's like a, you know, like a pad. When I say a pad, it will be like a rock-like structure. So imagine if this is like a, you know, like a hard thing, right? In front, you will have all of that. Yes, please repeat. Okay. Now in the mouth, we know that there is teeth, tongue, salivary glands. Now in the case of the teeth, we see that there are three kinds of teeth, where in cows we have incisors, premolars and molars. And we see that they do not have canines. They don't have canines because of what they eat, right? They eat on only plants. There is no need to tear into the food. That is something which would be required by an animal which is feeding on flesh. So we find them in omnivores and carnivores, but not herbivores, right? Yes. So now, of course, we know that the premolars, molars, incisors will help in biting into the food and, of course, chewing and crushing, right? So they will help with these two. Now we see that, of course, from the mouth as well, we also know that there is tongue that will help in mixing the food together. Saliva is produced, which is a watery fluid, which will bind everything together, right? And once it is bound and it is there, the cow will swallow it. And it will go into the remaining part of the digestive system. So far, I'm going very slowly because it's important to understand. Are we clear with the concept? So Ravinder, once again, they don't have canines because they eat on only plants, right? They don't need to feed on the meat. They don't do that, which is why we see that they have no canines. Very quickly, everybody, I want to show off hands. Yes. What does complex mean? Structurally, they are very complex. So imagine, a building is complex, but the simplest form of a building is the brick that is there. So that is the difference. Dental pad, yes, it's kind of like the teeth's nature only. They do have pancreas. They do. Good to go. Okay then. All right. No, ma'am, we are good to go. That is great. So I'll keep stopping here and there so that if you have any doubts, right? So there might be a point I may miss out on some doubts, but I'll stop to take doubts. And at that point, I'll clarify most of your doubts. I'll try my best to clarify all the doubts that you have, right? So now, of course, like any other digestive system, from the mouth, it will go into the esophagus. And then we see that from the esophagus, it will go to the second part, that is the stomach. And now it also has small intestine as well as large intestine. But here it's important to understand how it works, right? So once the food is swallowed, it will go from the esophagus and then it will go to the stomach. So they will swallow this grass, they will chew it and they'll bind it and they'll swallow it almost immediately, right? And this stomach that is there, yes, we see that it is a very large stomach. Now we know that it takes up a large portion of the cow's abdominal cavity, okay? So it's a very huge stomach. And if you see, this stomach is having four parts, not two. It does not have two things, right? But here if you see, it has four parts, or you can say four compartments. Yes. Why don't we study about other food of ruminants? So Janna, the thing is, the process is more or less the same. So we take one example to study the process. But it's more or less the same. four compartments, right? Yes, it says four, it is four compartments. And other questions like Jovika, what you are telling me, can we do it towards the end of the class? Because if I answer that, we'll be digressing from what we are learning right now, okay? I'll answer it towards the end. Yes. So there are four compartments and this is going to be some extra information, but you can write this down. It will definitely be helpful. Now the four compartments include rumen, we have reticulum, then there is omasum, right? And of course we have abomasum. Now you can write this down, it's completely okay. Now these are the four compartments which are going to be there, and we see that if you see this whole portion, all this that I'm scribbling on, this whole region that you see is actually the rumen. And rumen is the largest compartment that is there. Then of course we have reticulum, which is the small tubular structure you see. We have omasum, which is a circular portion. And then we have this portion, which is the abomasum. Right? So these are the four chambers or the four compartments which are there. Now what happens is that when the cow swallows the food, it will go from the esophagus and it will first go into the rumen. So here if you see, the arrows are very clear. The white arrow indicates the first time the food is entering. Now focus on the fact that I told you it is going in for the first time. Now it will go into the rumen. And we see that this rumen is extremely important because inside the rumen, we see that digestion starts to take place and partial digestion takes place, right? So the food becomes softened. So the food here becomes softened and partially digested. And this softened, partially digested food is what we call as a cut, right? So it's extremely important that you understand this. Now, why is this rumen so special? I mean, it's like any other stomach doing its job, right? So why is rumen so important and why should we study about it? Now, the thing is, the diet of the cow or diet of these ruminants is what we need to understand. They are feeding on plants only, right? And we know that plants in their cell wall have something known as cellulose. Now, cellulose cannot be digested by animals. Let me write that down. Cellulose cannot be broken down by the animal, but instead there are microorganisms that have the ability to break the cellulose down. And in the rumen of the cow we will find these microbes, and mainly they are bacteria, right? So here if you see, these microbes are present in the rumen and they will act on the cellulose by producing something known as cellulase. If you want to write this down, this is all extra, I'm telling you, but it's good to understand, right? So they will produce cellulase, which has the ability to break down the cellulose, thereby facilitating digestion, right? Or partial digestion, I would say. And of course, we also know that apart from digesting cellulose, we also, so I'm going to write this down. So in the rumen, cellulose will get digested. We also see that some complex starch will get digested, right? We also see that there is some proteins which will get broken down, right? And apart from that, some vitamins will also get synthesized by these bacteria. So are we clear with what happens inside the rumen? Yes, very quickly. Yes, there are helpful bacteria. And I'll give you an example also. It's a very easy one to remember. Ruminococcus species is an example of a bacteria that we find inside the rumen. Yes, all right. Cellulose. So Fateh, we are actually discussing this. So first, why cow has four parts, I'm telling you. We are in the process of learning it, so just be patient. Cellulose is a complex substance. Please write this down. Cellulose is a complex substance that we find in plant cells that actually gives the plant cell that rigidity, right? So that is what we mean by it. No, in the case of photosynthesis as well as digestion, please don't write it randomly, but in the sequence at which it takes place. Sequence is extremely important. Are we clear with what is cellulose, everybody? Yes? Quick response, everyone. Yes, amazing, everybody. All right. Quickly repeat once again, right? So we know that cellulose, will you write what is cellulose? I'll write it down. So we know that plants mainly, or these cows mainly feed on plant cells, right? Or they, you know, they feed on plants, right? And plants have cellulose in them. Now, in order to digest it, we require some chemical or an enzyme known as cellulase, right? So the cellulase is the thing that will help in breaking this cellulose down into simpler form so that we can digest it, right? Now, we see that the animal or the cow in itself does not have that ability. But the rumen of the cow, which is the largest chamber of the stomach, hosts some bacteria that has the ability to break the cellulose down. Which is why we see that the cellulose gets broken down, complex starch will get digested, right? And we also see that there are some other substances which get synthesized. So what is cellulose? Cellulose is a substance that makes up cell wall of plant cells. I hope this was helpful. Yes, Aryan, please tell me, are we clear, everybody? So that I can move on to the next part. Cellulose is fiber. Cellulose is not fiber, okay? Because cellulose is a substance that makes up the cell wall. That's important to understand. It's kind of like a carbohydrate, but I think it might get a little tricky. Let's just simply understand this. Cellulose is a complex substance that makes up the cell wall, right? Cell wall is nothing but the outer covering that you see of the cell that I'm highlighting. Oops, not that part. Yes, this is the cell wall. Are we clear? All right, so we'll go into rumen. Rumen is largest chamber, right? Largest chamber has bacteria in it, right? And of course, we know that the bacteria will break down cellulose. Very simple and easy. Now what happens is that ideally when four compartments are there, we'll think, right? It'll go from 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, 4 to 5. That is the order that we always think. But the thing here is that after this cud is formed, right, in the rumen, and maybe some of it will also go to the reticulum also. But the main thing you need to understand is that once this cud is formed, it will go back to the mouth. So here what happens is that partially digested food is going back to the mouth, right? And now what will happen is the cow will further chew it. And now it also makes up a space where some of the other enzymes or other chemicals which are there in its saliva can act on the food, right? So here what happens is that the cud goes back into the mouth. And this process is why we call as rumination, right? What is rumination? Rumination is a process where partially digested food called as cud from the stomach goes back to the mouth for further digestion or breakdown to take place. And such organisms or animals that exhibit this are known as ruminants. And we call this as the chewing of cud, right? So this is what we will observe. So in this case, we see that the food that is there will go back to the mouth. And it gets further broken down. Why doesn't those enzymes go into the rumen? Now see, for any enzymes or chemicals to work, they need the right kind of atmosphere, right? So it requires the right kind of chemical atmosphere, I would say. The right balance of chemicals. And it is not there in the rumen. Which is why certain processes take place in the rumen, certain processes take place in the mouth, right? So that is important to understand. And a very interesting thing that I forgot to tell you is that in the rumen, there are also some certain gases which get produced. So we see that methane, carbon dioxide, they are all released inside the rumen as well. Yes? So now that we have understood this part, right? So now chewing of cud has taken place. It's further gotten broken down, right? Yes, and once it is broken down, it will go back again to the mouth through the esophagus. Yes, very good. So here the esophagus is, you know, helping with two-way movement, right? So here what is happening in the esophagus, there is two-way movement. Now in our esophagus, what happens is normally, if there's no other, you know, issues, once we swallow it, it's not going to come back. But sometimes if it's not swallowed properly or maybe due to some other reasons, we may regurgitate it back or vomit it out. But most often than not, in a normal process, it does not happen. It's only one-way movement, right? Yes, esophagus is the food pipe. But in this case, for the cows, naturally only two-way movement will take place. So it'll go into the rumen, some of it will go to the reticulum also. I'm again specifying that some of it will go to the reticulum, right? And then we see here that once the chewing of cud has taken place, it will swallow it back, where from the reticulum, it will go into the omasum, right? And in the omasum, we see that there's some amount of absorption, right? So in omasum, what we observe is, let me use another color maybe. Yes, so in Umasam we see that there is some amount. I am specifying that it's not allowed, not a lot, but some amount of water absorption takes place, right? And we see that the remaining bit of it will go into the next chamber, that is the abomasum, which is considered to be the true stomach of a ruminant. Can you believe that? In those four compartments, abomasum is considered to be the true stomach. Because of course, we see that digestive enzymes like pepsin, protein breakdown takes place, and it pretty much functions like our stomach, where some hydrochloric acid is produced, right? And we see that normal digestion of food will take place. And once all of this is done, it will go from the stomach to the intestines. And the intestine, if you see here, is highly coiled. It's extremely long, right? It's about, in some cases, 150 feet long, right? And of course, we see that in the intestine, it receives juices from the liver and the pancreas. So a lot of you are asking me, ma'am, does cow have liver and pancreas? Yes, they do. They do have liver and pancreas. They'll secrete their juices, digestion, complete digestion takes place, and we know that nutrients are absorbed in the small intestine. And we see that before it goes into the large intestine, they have this pouch-like structure. Okay, let me highlight it in blue. There is this pouch-like structure which is present in the beginning of the large intestine, which is what we call as a cecum. Right, so they have something known as cecum, but this cecum is not very active, like the cecum doesn't do much, okay? And we see that from the cecum, it will go into the large intestine where water is removed, water is reabsorbed, right? And of course, we know that eventually it will be ejected out, yes? So it will be removed out, or undigested food will be ejected out. Will cow pancreas produce hormones? Cow pancreas will, hormones, yes, will be produced, but in this case, they'll produce digestive enzymes. What is the use of pancreas? Pancreas help in the producing digestive juices that facilitate digestion, right? Why doesn't it chew only at once while taking it? Very interesting question, Riddhi. Now, the thing is, because of plant and the nature, right, of the plants that they eat, they feed on grasses, right? They feed on things that are not really edible for us also, right? They feed on grass. Sometimes, you know, the plants are really, when you look at it, their nature is very different. Now, the thing is, at one go, if they were able to do it, they could. But the thing is that because of the chemical complexity of the food that they eat, they need to first partially digest and soften it, right? And we require microbes to act on it. Then further, to facilitate digestion, they go, they regurgitate it back into their mouth for the chewing of cud process, where further chemical action takes place. Only then we see that they will be able to digest it out, right? So that is very important to understand. Do they have gallbladders? So I'm not very sure of this. I do not want to give an answer because I'm not sure of this, but I'll definitely let you know, Dilip. Yes, and for KV girl as well, I'm not very sure of this answer and I don't want to say something wrong, right? So I'll definitely get back to you on this. Because in my memory, I don't think they have it, but again, I could be wrong. So I will let you know. Why is cecum removed by natural selection? So see, in cows especially, we see that cecum does not really serve a purpose. But in other herbivores, we see that they do serve a purpose, which is why over time they're still there. Gaseous exchange takes place in rumen. No, the gases are then given out, right? So normally in this case, there will not be gaseous exchange taking place, but these gases will be given out through the natural course of the digestive system, right? Why body needs nutrients? Nutrients are needed for growth, for development, right? We need nutrients for all of it. And of course, for day-to-day activities to take place, which is why we need nutrients. Gaseous exchange will not take place in rumen. Gases will be given out. All right, how many teeth do they have? Roughly around 32, but again, the number is not something I'm going to confirm, right? Yes. All right, everyone, are we clear with how digestion? What is the function of cecum? Again, in cecum, they serve a very primitive role in cows, right? So here they just act as a large sac through which the food passes through. Why is cecum not active? Because in this case, we see that their role is not there, right? Because normally in other animals that are there, for example, like in horses, the cecum is something that is functional. And Janath, we are going to talk about it, so don't worry. Are we clear, everybody? Give me a quick show of hands. Are we clear with the concept of digestion in ruminants? And like I told you, in 30 minutes, I have wrapped it up, right? Very good, everybody. Very good. And I'm very happy that all of you are asking me a lot of interesting questions. Very happy about it. I have a doubt. Whoever has doubt, please tell me. Okay. Now, of course, like I told you, right? Many animals, including humans, cannot digest cellulose, which is why sometimes a lot of plant-based leafy food items are part of roughage, right? Because we don't have the ability to digest it, it just forms bulk of the undigested food and we are giving it out. Why is it needed in cecum in horse? I'm telling you in just a bit, right? I'll do a quick revision once again in the end. But very quickly, everybody, here are two important questions for all of you. Curd is formed in which region of the cow? Is it esophagus, rumen, is it in small intestine or large intestine? Can you all tell me very quickly in the chat? Yes, everyone. Very good, very good. Curd is formed in the rumen, right? Yes. Now, of course, before I come back to this doubt board, here is a quick fact on cecum because a lot of you are asking me about it, right? So we know that in the case of, in the case of horses, we see that cecum exists between the esophagus and the small intestine. And in the cow, we know that these microbes that digest cellulose are found in rumen. But in horses, we see that this cecum that is there, this labeling might be incorrect, so don't focus on it. But the cecum that is there helps in the breakdown, or they have certain bacteria in the cecum that help with the digestion, right? So that is the role of cecum. They host those digestive bacteria that are there. And that's why in the case of cows, because it's already found in the rumen, there's no point, right? Most of it is done in the rumen itself. All right. So are we clear, everyone? Any more doubts that are there, I will take it in this doubt board, right? Because I think the doubt board should have moved earlier. Yes, you can check that out. Everybody, quick show of hands and I'll wind it up with another question and a homework question for all of you, right? The bacteria that are there in the cows are not harmful, right? They are good only. So they're helping it out. What is cecum is a large pouch that is there, which exists between the esophagus and the large intestine. In the case of cows, it is not very functional, but in the case of horses, they host a lot of, bacteria that are there. How do cows identify? So I'll tell you, that is the nature of, the way in which the digestive system, the way the muscles contract, right? So we know that the whole digestive system is a muscular tube that is there. And it comes with how the body's nervous system is and how the cow is as an organism. The muscular contraction will direct it to there as well. That is how they will know, right? Oh, of course you can, please do ask doubts related to the concept that we are studying about. Why is it not removed by natural selection? See, natural selection is not something that will take place in one day or 2 days or maybe even few months or years. It will take a long time, right? So it's important to understand that. Reticulum is one among the compartments of the stomach in ruminants. Yes, I hope that is clear. And yes, you need to write it in sequence for photosynthesis because you've been constantly asking me, Jannat, reactants, then you need to write down the conditions and then the products. So you need to write it in sequence. And it is for all of you students, not just for Jannat, right? Yes, it is clear. Now, quick question for all of you. Which among the following animal does not have a cecum that has bacteria, right? That has bacteria in it. Very quickly, can you take a guess? Let me give you a hint. This is something we will find in herbivores, right? So identify which is not a herbivore. Very easy, everyone. Correct answer is tiger. Very good. Now, of course, we've learnt about the digestive system in humans. We've learnt about it in animals, right? And we've looked at ruminants also. But what about a unicellular organism like amoeba? How does this whole process take place? Well, you will find out immediately in half an hour, right at 8 p.m. So this will not be a live class. This is a small recorded video that I have made where you will be able to learn about digestion in amoeba in just under 15 minutes. It's going to be a very simple video, but I want all of you to be a part of it so that you can understand how the digestion takes place. Yes? Now, before I wind up, this is the homework question for all of you. Describe the role of rumen in cows. So I want you to give me the answer for the homework question. I want you to drop it in the comments and we will be discussing the answers very, very soon. And for those of you who are asking me about the Telegram link, we know that Telegram is a small community where we give you session notes, PDFs, and we will be coming live on Fridays as well. So stay tuned for that. Link is available in the description box, right? And for Jovika, who you were asking me about the BST, right? Yes, you had applied some time, but now you are not able to register. So Jovika, what I would like you to do is again drop this comment in the comment section, because our team is constantly checking the comments, and if they find that there is some issue with you, they will try their best to resolve it. So could you please drop it? We will definitely get back to you on this. And you know that no matter what, we've got you covered, right? So to show your love to us, please hit the like button, share this with your friends, stay subscribed to our channel for more such interesting sessions, because we'll always make sure that we will help you out in all ways, right? So everyone, with this, we come to the end of today's class. Hoping to see you very soon again. Bye-bye and have a nice day.